Hello and welcome to episode 113 of the True Achievements podcast. I am here today with a hungover Jack.
Not hungover, I don't think.
Oh, that's not fair. I'm really hungover. And probably a very, very sober Dave.
Hello, not spoken to you for ages.
Haven't you? No, feels like at least 2 days.
I know.
That was an epic as well. I hope everyone enjoyed the History of TA podcast. Didn't quite realize it was going to be quite so long. I also meant to say at the end of it, which I completely forgot to say, here's to another 10 years. And thanks to all the community. I was listening to it the other day. I was like, oh, didn't even say thanks to all the community. So thanks to all the community. You're amazing. And here's to another 10 years. That was supposed to be the end. Maybe you can edit that onto it. We'll republish.
Yeah, I'll put it in my video. Yeah.
So the reason we're hungover is, or I'm hungover, is Jack and I went all the way to Brizzle to watch the Wombats last night, who are excellent at the O2 Brizzle Academy. Which was ace. Good venue, wasn't it, Jack?
Yeah, great venue.
Great venues. Good band. They're a fantastic live band. If ever you get the chance to see the Wombats, please do so. And Bristol was quite cool. We had quite a nice time in there. Found a wonderful bar called Kong's Kitchen that had loads of old arcade cabinets, including 1942, which I'm still good at, even after all these years. So I managed to make my credit last for ages, which was good, and got on the high scoreboard because I'm the man. So yes, we should talk about games because there's been some big ones and some blooming good ones at that as well. Spoilers. So do you guys want to start? You've both been playing A Way Out.
We have played it together.
Yep.
Oh.
Yeah. It was. Yeah. So this was one we would both kind of been waiting for. It obviously. They'd announced beforehand that you could play it with somebody else without them owning a copy of it.
Yeah,
and we thought, cool, if the achievements pop on the copy and you don't have to own it, we may as well just buy one copy and kind of split the difference or whatever. The people on site obviously tested it pretty much straight away to see if the achievements would pop, and they didn't on the free version of it. Mm. So we both picked up a version.
So the way that works, by the way, for those that are planning on playing this with someone else, is they can just download a trial.
Yeah, free trial, but it's the full game. It's just doesn't pop the achievements.
And presumably you can't start that until you're invited in by someone who has the real game.
Yeah, I'm guessing not. Yeah.
But you both have the game.
It obviously locked down your ability in that, I guess, to invite other people as well.
Yes. So. Okay, makes sense. Mm.
But we started it on Tuesday night, and we finished on Monday night, and we finished it on Tuesday evening.
So total time?
About 6.5 hours, I think.
Okay. And tell us about the game.
I'll hand over to Dave, because I've done a lot of speaking.
To be honest, I thought it looked really good from what we'd seen, you know, at E3 and on trailers and stuff. But I was way more impressed once we actually started playing it. Like, if you've played Brothers, you can kind of see how the concepts of Brothers, where you were controlling two characters with the thumbsticks.
Yeah, I struggled with that.
So, yeah, you can see where it's kind of developed into this co-op experience with two different players. But it's
Same developer?
Yeah, same developer as Brothers.
Ah, I didn't know that.
There's loads of cool little Easter eggs back to Brothers as well. Do you know, because Brothers, if you played that, you could play through the whole game, do the whole story, which was worth doing, but you wouldn't necessarily unlock any achievements because they're all like little side things.
Yes.
And this is exactly the same way. Like, you play through the whole story, then it's like interacting with something or doing something that's not actually anything to do with the story as part of unlock the achievements, which I thought was pretty cool. The way it's done is, like, even if you're playing online, like me and Jack were, it's still split screen as if you were playing couch co-op.
Now that's weird, isn't it?
It was at first, and it kind of messed up my head a couple of times when we were playing it.
I was just very surprised because I'd seen some trailers and some footage, and I just always assumed that people were sitting on a couch next to each other.
Yeah,
I didn't realize it'd be remote, kind of split screen like that. But it works.
So you can basically see what your partner is seeing as well as what you're seeing.
So there's a section near the start of a game, and you've got to kind of time some stuff to happen, and one of you's got to be lookout. But Dave was lookout, and he was kind of looking down a corridor either way, and I could obviously utilize his screen and just tell him to look in the opposite direction and then go on with a different action on my screen. It worked really well. So it takes out the aspect of you having to communicate every single minute thing you're doing to the other person. It's almost like you're in their headspace at the same time.
Awesome.
It's hard to explain the game because it's kind of like, a story of like a Telltale game where the story is quite deep and in depth and it's kind of quite slow and meandering at points. And then all of a sudden it'll turn into this crazy action game and it's like a Call of Duty where you're like shooting off the back of a car and one of you is driving and the other one's shooting out the back and then racing motorbikes, we're on boats. There was loads of crazy stuff. And then the split screen's done really well. So you've got most of the game, it's split like down the center of the screen, left and right. And then when there's something kind of more important going on, or maybe like a bit of a cutscene going on with one character, it'll kind of expand that. But it's really like a smooth transition and narrow the other screen, or it might go to one screen, or it might go top and bottom. But it sounds like it's atrocious and it'll mess your eyes up, but it works really well. And then one minute we were like, most of the game you're playing like a third person, and then all of a sudden there was a bit that was like a top down section. And then there was a bit that was like a side on like Street Fighter type game. It was just incredible. It's so well thought out and put together.
So at one point we were kind of navigating our way through a building and it split the characters up to some degree. And you had, this was one of the only points in the game where it's just one character on the screen at one time, but it'd go from Dave's perspective, then he'd do some actions, then the camera'd kind of fly through an air vent or it would transition in a really just smooth way, like out a window and down a floor to my character. And then I'd take over. So it's like he was getting a little bit of action, then I was getting a bit of action, then swapping over. Yeah, no, it's spot on though. Really good.
Okay, so we are doing a review.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we won't spoil the score, but safe to say you both loved it.
Yeah. Okay. As well, I noticed there was a forum post in the game forum this week, and it's really true that your last achievement may be 30 minutes or so before the end of the game. Don't just go, oh, I've got the achievements now, I'm quitting. The end of the game is just so worth finishing off because I've seen people saying, you know, oh, I could see this coming all the way through the game. I wasn't expecting it. I don't think Jack was, and it was pretty epic, and it was so good that then as soon as we finished, we were like, oh, we'll do it again together in a couple of days, you know, because these two characters, there's two different endings. Over. And then it was like, nah, shall we do it now? So we like sat back and did the final section again. So
oh, wicked.
It's crazy, well worth it.
It's really good with the chapter select as well. You can hop back to pretty much any point in the game after you've finished it.
So if you did miss any of the achievements.
Yeah, which is great. And there's nothing tied to, there's no actual difficulty in it, which for me just highlights that they were all about the story. That's all they cared about. They didn't want a veteran and an easy difficulty or whatever. And nothing was really difficult. It's basically a series of simple puzzles, most of it, and some fighting sections, but really good.
Okay.
Enjoyed it a lot
excellent.
More than I
look
thought.
Forward to reading the review.
Perfect length for a game as well.
Yeah, no, it sounds good. So just a reminder, if you buy a copy of that, you can play it with someone else that doesn't have a copy. They just won't unlock the achievements. Awesome. So that's one good game. I've been playing a rather special game as well, which is Far Cry 5. So anyone that follows me on Twitter will see how excited I've been getting about this game over the last week or so. It released properly on Tuesday, but I'd been playing it since last week. Ubisoft very kindly gave me a copy of the game early. And it's amazing. It's properly amazing. I thought Far Cry 3 was my game of that year, whatever year that came out. And this is almost definitely going to be my game of 2018, and I'm only about halfway through it so far, but I just absolutely love it. It looks beautiful. It's absolutely glorious graphically. Really cool environments. It's set in, I think it's set in Austin or near Austin, Texas, and it's mountainous, but there's lakes, woods, forests, fields, towns. The only thing it doesn't have is a big city, I suppose, but you wouldn't expect that in this game. And it's, I would imagine most people know the plot, but it's about a religious cult run by a man called Joseph Seed. And the map is quite cool. So as usual for Ubisoft, the map's pretty big, but it's not as unmanageable as, say, Assassin's Creed or one of those games. It looks like it's not that difficult to traverse it. And of course, you can get in an aeroplane or a helicopter, which you can't do in Assassin's Creed. So it's not as daunting as I remember the first time I looked at the map in Assassin's Creed, I was almost in tears. The thought of having to go and clean up all those icons. And also, unlike Assassin's Creed and Wildlands and many of those other games, it doesn't feel like an icon hunt. You know, normally in those games, those Ubisoft open world games, you're just constantly moving from icon to icon to icon to try and do things. This doesn't feel anywhere near like that. It's much less icon related shenanigans in this game. So you can just sort of progress at any pace you like. It's got a very cool perk system. So there are multiple challenges that are to do with hunting or shooting or just various other bits and bobs. And as you complete each of those challenges as you play the game, they're just sort of running constantly in the background. You earn perk points, and with those perk points, you can buy skills. Now, Bex works it out that there are not enough perk points available to buy all the skills, so you need to pick and choose the ones you want. I would recommend anyone immediately doubles their health. So you get perk points for things like just killing people, killing enemies. I think you get 3 for killing 20 enemies or something like that. But you also get them for killing enemies with specific weapons. So there's one for killing enemies with the bow, which is great because it forces you to use all the different weapon types. Normally with a game like that, you just find an assault rifle that you're happy with and you stick with it. But with this, you're forced to, because you need the perk points. The game is brutally difficult. I've dropped it down to easy, but I've still got, I think, over 100 deaths that I've had in my 20 hours. That is one of the stats that is tracked, how many times you've died. So you can see that on TA. But yeah, it's an absolutely fantastic game. The weapons all feel really solid, really chunky. The map itself is split into 3 regions. So Joseph Seed, the main guy, he has 3 family members and they each run an area. So you have to clear those areas one by one and progress the story that way. But it works really, really well. It is brutally tough, though. There is some annoying bits, like sometimes I've spawned and then an enemy plane has just seen me and just rained down bullets on me and I've died almost immediately. And then that happened over and over again. So as soon as I spawned, I had to teleport somewhere else so that I didn't get killed straight away. But you can get perks to make yourself harder to spot, and obviously increasing the health, that makes things considerably easier. So I would recommend doing that. I also dropped the difficulty down to easy pretty much straight away. And the opening scene is immense. One of the best opening scenes I've ever played in any game. And yeah, it's just an absolutely awesome game. I am very much looking forward to finishing it. It's odd for me to actually think about a game all the time I'm not playing it. And that's pretty much what I've been doing with Far Cry 5. So I highly recommend it. Go and get it. We have a review coming soon. Not exactly sure when. But yeah, it's an awesome game. Awesome game. Right. Anything else that you guys have been playing? Jack, have you been playing anything else?
I started one of the latest games with Gold Games, Super Hot.
Ooh, Super Hot.
Yeah, exactly.
Remember that trailer, yeah.
That's pretty much the game as well, no. So
they say it in the game, don't they?
Yeah, this is a really cool idea for a game. The concept is you move forward or backward, and as you're moving, time progresses, and it'll only progress when you're moving or if you're performing an action. They're red dudes in the levels, and you'll sometimes be unarmed, but if you walk forward towards the red dude, they'll start moving, and you've got to try and eliminate all the people, basically. You can find guns in some of the levels, so you pick up a gun, you'll shoot a bullet. That bullet will move kind of a little bit away from your gun in air initially, but you've actually got to move to make that bullet progress forward and make time progress and try and work out where the enemy's going to be for your shot to be able to hit him, because they're usually moving as well. You can kind of throw items and objects at enemies, and if they've got a gun, the gun will pop out of their hand and make its way toward you, so you can pick up guns midair, which is amazing. But the game itself, I'd say it's almost a little bit puzzly in the respect that enemies are shooting at you. You've got to kind of avoid their bullets, but you can think about the actions, and there's stopping time in it. So you've got to be careful in that aspect. But it's really cool, actually. Much better than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah, it reviewed really well, didn't it?
Yeah, and at the end of each level, after you've completed it, it gives you a replay of the level, but back in real time, so without any of the stoppage. And it makes you look elite. makes you feel really, really pleased. But that's really good. I'd highly recommend picking
it
up.
Is it still available?
Still available for download, I think.
Okay, so you've probably got 2 days left for that?
It's got quite a high TA, so I think there's some difficult achievements chucked in.
There is a walkthrough on the site, because I had a look at that when it was announced that it was going to be out. They actually recommend doing it twice, so playing it through for fun first and then going back and mopping up, because apparently it's very cool. Excellent, I look forward to playing that. I've been carrying on with my challenge, but not really in the background. It's just happened to pop a few. We were doing GTSC this week, so there was a bonus week announced where we have to pop 12 five gamer score achievements. Is that right? Yeah, both members had to pop 5-12 gamer score achievements. So I've played quite a bit of Gears of War 4, somewhat ridiculously for a game that has 3,000 gamer score. Each campaign, like main storyline achievement, is only worth 5. So I just plodded along with some more of that. This game is so dull. It's just the same thing in every room. And it's grim as well. It's lots of pus and blood and guts all over the place. It's pretty disgusting. So not particularly enjoying that, although I'm very close to finishing the story now, so I might just do that. But it doesn't, you know, when it takes that long and you're only getting 5 gamer score for each bit, it's a bit depressing. And we popped a load in Gimme 5, the Windows 10 quiz game, because they were all worth 5 as well. And I've been playing Tesla versus Lovecraft, which you streamed, Jack.
Yeah.
You weren't very good at it.
No, I was terrible.
It's actually much harder in co-op, so it has a co-op mode.
So it's a top-down shoot-em-up kind of.
Twin-stick shooter, yeah. It's awesome. I think, did I talk about it last week? I can't actually remember. But it's really, really good. Highly recommend it. Grab it. It's not particularly expensive, I think. ID type. One of the best ID games I've played.
Yeah, you can get most of the achievements in about 6 hours, can't you? I think.
Well, you can get most of the achievements in the first hour.
Okay.
But yeah, to finish the game, it takes about 6 hours. I've got all but 2, I think, now, and I've probably put in 2.5 hours, something like that. But the last ones, you effectively have to play the game again each time, so you play it in a different environment. But it's really good fun. Dave, have you been playing anything else?
Not really. It's all been kind of nonsense for that 5G challenge. So
okay.
Microsoft Sudoku Japan Edition included, so...
I didn't even know there was one of those.
Yeah. Got to switch your computer to Japanese and then download it from the store.
Do you? Amazing. Have you learned any Japanese?
No.
Been playing that?
No.
Not very helpful. Okay, Jack, you've been playing Murdered Soul Suspect on 2 different consoles at the same time.
Yeah, so I played this one simultaneously. It wasn't a particularly great game. Didn't enjoy it. But I figured I had a bit of time.
Like twice.
Just wanted to finish it off. Yeah, I got to a point where I was kind of 70% of the way through both of them. I thought, let's just bite the bullet and go for it. Not a great game, though. Would not recommend it, and definitely wouldn't recommend playing it twice. And then I've just played some other random stuff as well for the 5 gamer score achievements. I've started yet another version of Batman Arkham Asylum, which is Game of the Year version on the Xbox 360.
Game of every year for you, that.
Yeah, really good game. And Batman Arkham City on the Xbox One as well. A couple of 5 okay. gamer scores in that.
Cool. Let's talk about streams quickly then. So Tesla versus Lovecraft, we just mentioned. It's really good. You can check out our video of the first hour. So as I mentioned, 9 achievements in the first hour for 430 gamer score. So that's hefty. And then you played a game called The Count Lucanor.
Yeah. So this one was a little bit weird. It was very stylistic. It was like 8-bit, kind of top down. You play a little kid, you start from the house, and then you leave the house and start. You come across some people you can help. So there's like a donkey you can give some apples to, a guy that you can offer coins to. And you eventually come across a castle, and stuff starts going a little bit crazy. You end up in some kind of alternate world, I suppose. And there's this little jester character that's flying around, and you've got to try and figure out his name. And that seems to be, I think it's random, but you've basically got to go through this fortress, which is a little bit like a maze, find different rooms, buy different keys, do different puzzles in order to find the keys, and didn't really get too far in, I don't think. It was a little bit unforgiving as well, so it was a manual save system. We died at one point and didn't realize it was a manual save system. It took us pretty much all the way back to the start.
I heard Ollie's depressing tones. He realized how far you'd gone back. Cool. Okay. And we've got more streams happening today. We're recording a day early today, by the way, because it's Good Friday tomorrow. So the office is closed.
So today we've got Cube 2 and Where Are My Friends?
Ooh, Cube 2
coming up.
Okay. Interesting. Cool. So we'll talk about those next week. Site news for a change. We've got some new filters on all of our game and achievement lists, which now allow, I think I spoke about this before, but you can now choose back compat as well as normal Xbox One for your filters. And we've also added loads of additional functionality. So there's more options. You can choose the distribution type, so whether it's digital or retail or disc, I suppose you call it. And you can choose the gamer score values. So you can filter just on a gamer score of 5, which is very helpful for us. Or if you want to get off of your wonky number, you can choose a different gamer score. So basically find all achievements that don't end in a 5 or a 0 to help you get off your wonky score, if you're one of those people that hates that. And I know there's lots of you out there.
Love a wonky
score.
So yeah,
that's pretty cool. Thanks to feedback from the initial news story, we have also added a release year dropdown to that as well. So you can choose just to see games that released in a certain year, which is pretty cool. I think probably quite unique.
Mm. Yeah, and if you think of anything else that would be useful, let us know, because it's much easier for us to add new stuff like that in now.
Yeah,
for restructure.
Yeah, we've got new more room, which is good. Okay, cool. I mentioned earlier the History of TrueAchievements podcast that went up on Dave. When did it go up?
About 11 o'clock on Wednesday night.
Okay, 11 o'clock on Wednesday night. So that is, if you want to listen to me get emotional at times and explain exactly where we've been, why TA exists, how it's grown, how it's changed, the difficulties we've had, the challenges we've had, how what it's like working with Microsoft, all of those things, check out that podcast. It is available on the same feed as this one. So just go back one episode and you'll find it. It's long, bear in mind. You want to set aside 2 hours to listen to it. But brilliant, obviously. I'm not really selling it. It's really good. Promise. It's really good. Regular news, Dave.
Okay, so we got the Games with Gold titles for April announced a couple of days ago. We are going to get The Witness throughout the whole of April on the Xbox One. And then we're going to get Assassin's Creed Syndicate April the 16th to May the 15th. That's probably like my third favorite Assassin's Creed game. So if you...
That's good news for me. I've been looking, waiting for that one to go on sale for ages, but now I don't need to wait.
I already own that.
It is really good, so check that one out. And then on the 360...
Is that the one in London?
It is, yeah. The London thing. I think
it's one even got to... It's one Harry's got about 200 hours in, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah. Big shout out to my mate Harry. He doesn't play a lot of games, but all he plays is Assassin's Creed Syndicate.
I think he even got to Croydon at one point or something like that.
Oh, no, the character's from EG, isn't he? It mentioned Grinstead.
No, tell you what about East Grinstead Day. They released a promo trailer for Far Cry 5 video that's filmed in East Grinstead, where I live. How mad is that? It's by Danny Wallace, who is a Ubisoft favourite. He did the voicing for Desmond, is it? I think, in the Assassin's Creed game.
He starred in it. It was his likeness.
And he starred in it. There you go. Well, he presents it. If you want to see what my hometown is like, it's not a great representation, because the only reason they came here is because there's lots of religious centres here. So there's a Mormon temple here. There's Scientology nutters here. So that's why they came here. That was the pretense. And they didn't even interview me. It seems
you need to start
wrong,
some kind
really.
Of religious cult.
Maybe I should. True religion. TrueGod.com. I can give you points.
Okay.
See how Christian you are.
Moving on, we've got... on the 360, we've got Cars 2 from April the 1st to April the 15th.
Oh, you love those games, don't you?
No. I had to review one and it wasn't my favourite game. And Dead Space 2 from the 16th to the 30th. So that's a pretty
spooky.
Decent month.
Yeah,
I saw the feedback in the thread. Lots of people very happy about that list, which is great. It's cool that Games of Gold continues to be full. I mean, there was a few people that were quite cynical of the program initially, but I think most months there's at least one or two games for pretty much everybody can enjoy.
Yeah, for sure.
So well done, Microsoft.
Similar free games, if you've got Xbox Game Pass, the additions for April have been announced. So we've got City Skylines, that was already revealed. We've got Cluster Truck, Kingdom New Lands, Late Shift, Portal Knights, RoboCraft Infinity, and The Hunter Call of the Wild on the Xbox One, and Sacred Citadel on the 360. So I know from looking at that, I think Late Shift is easy completion. So there's definitely...
So Late Shift is the live action film.
FMV.
You sort of control the plot a bit. You have to play through it multiple times to complete it, I believe. But it's not
I think you can do it in about two playthroughs. You can okay. pause and quit out at specific points before it hits an autosave and then go back in and choose the other option.
Yeah, if you play it, follow the walkthrough, because I think there's eight endings properly, but yeah, you can kind of just, at certain checkpoints, you can get two endings and then move on and do another ending and stuff like that. So walkthrough is really good for that.
Okay.
Sea of Thieves, it's had a bit of a troubled launch, I think it's fair to say.
Stormy.
They've had a...
I would go with.
They've had way more players than I think they could ever have expected, which I don't think is surprising, considering it was free if you were on Games Pass.
It was also, though, the number one seller in the UK that week.
That's crazy.
Straight in at number one.
Not a lot must have sold that week, I guess.
Well,
I can't imagine loads of people had bought it if it's free.
Well, they did.
It's crazy. But,
I promise you, they did.
They've had some troubles. They've done all sorts of stuff. I think basically one of the biggest problems is there's a lot of rewards and things in game, and they all run on like a feed. So you send your info off to the server to say, I've done this, and then it sends it back to unlock it in your game. And that's a similar kind of way that the achievements work, and it's all been kind of clogging up and backlogs of that stuff. So they've turned off the achievements at certain points over the past week. I think they even did that again over the weekend just to try and get people in the game and get it working. And they've announced this week some of the patches that are coming. I think there's a full game download that you have to do again to fix some of the stuff. So it's like a, I don't know how big.
And for a while that was broken because it wasn't appearing in game. For anyone using Game Pass, they couldn't re-download the game. So no one could play it for about 8 hours. Okay. Not great.
So that patch is live, so hopefully they should fix some of that stuff. But I know there was a video that they recorded. No, they said that they still try to mitigate the issue of people not being able to get in and try to get people matched up and stuff is the main priority. So, but if you are popping achievements, they are getting sent to them still. So they've got the data to say that you've done it, and once they do turn them on, they should all kind of stream through.
See, Jack and I were talking about that on the train back today, and I mean, I'm not calling anyone a liar. But that seems odd. I mean, the popping of the achievements is the easiest part of that. It's just literally one little API call. So it seems really odd that they, in theory, have stored all the rewards that you need to fire off these achievements, but they're not popping them. It seems very strange to me.
Yeah, fingers crossed it will resolve itself when they and will
Can
actually
imagine
pop
if
all
they
the stuff.
Come back on and they're not.
Yeah, if they come back on and they haven't got that data or they don't pop, there'll be a lot of angry people.
Our review is up. Mark gave it a 4 out of 5, I think.
Okay, that's respectful.
He loves it, it's fair to say. He's really enjoying it. It has some problems, the non technical problems. It has some issues with. I think the game doesn't really get going properly until you've put about 15 to 20 hours in. My issue with it is that it seems your enjoyment factor is almost definitely tied to how well your interactions with other people go, and that is obviously something that the game itself can't control. So you're almost at the mercy of the randoms that you meet and the randoms that you sail with if you happen to just sail with random people in your ship as well. I don't know. People, I think that's why the reviews are so mixed.
I saw quite an amusing tweet yesterday. Somebody had tweeted Rare and said this was my first impression of the game. So he'd been playing it solo, jumped into a multiplayer game of four. The three people on his ship trolled him, kind of locked him in a room. Then one of them stood outside playing music while two of them got drunk. And then apparently when you get drunk, you can be sick.
Yeah,
they were being sick, and the other one was catching it in a bucket and then just throwing it over him. And they did that to him for about half an hour, and that was his impression of the game.
There you go, 5 out of 5. Game of the year.
We've had a question about this, the lines of the game mechanics from Kingsley. When a game's achievements are blocked, Sea of Thieves, do you find your enjoyment of the game diminish during that time, or you find yourself not wanting to play it as much?
So I'm trying to think of any other game where this has ever happened that I've played, and I can't think of one off the top of my head, but imagining the fact that it was happening in, say, Far Cry. Oh, actually, there are times when I've had a game in advance. In fact, Far Cry, there you go. This only happened to me last week. That's how hungover I am, that I can't remember last week. When I received Far Cry, the achievements weren't live, so I was playing it blind. Yeah, and it is weird. I mean, to be honest, Far Cry is a good enough game that it didn't matter to me anyway. But it is slightly odd because there are points that you think, oh, I bet that would have been an achievement pop. Mm-hmm. Like at the end of a big mission or once something cool happens. but you don't know. It's quite frustrating.
I bet it was interesting looking back over the achievements when they did go live and seeing what had actually popped and kind of going, yeah, that was a popping point and I guessed that correctly or whatever.
Yeah, exactly that. I don't know. Sea of Thieves one is weird because everyone knows what the achievements are. And they probably know that they should have popped them, I would imagine. So it's going to be really interesting if they don't pop when they come back online. There could be quite a lot of anger. But there's a lot of people really enjoying Sea of Thieves. So I don't know. Lots of people not enjoying it, lots of people enjoying it. So it's a bit of a mixed bag. I think, back to the question, I think it would diminish it a bit if achievements weren't popping.
Especially
that is one of the reasons.
If you're expecting them to pop, I think it diminished them. If it didn't have them from the get-go, it was released in like game preview without them, then it wouldn't hurt it at all. But if you...
No, because your expectations...
Yeah, it's the old give something, then take it away, isn't it?
But I'm kind of... like I'm not playing PlayerUnknown's Battleground. I played it initially because I was about to see what all the hype was about. Thought it was a bit broken and left it. And I've seen the updates going up. I think they were up to 12 now, something like that. And saying how everything's improved, but nothing makes me want to play the game at the minute. Maybe when the achievements release.
Do you think achievements would be the motivator that would make you...
Yeah, because even though I don't really play specifically for achievements, like when I play a game, I'm kind of, you know, looking around and seeing what achievements there are and seeing when I can get them and stuff like that.
I suppose so something...
It has kind of influenced me a bit.
Something like PUBG, where it's kind of small, short matches as well, it gives you something else to do rather than just kind of mindless multiplayer, same thing over and over again. It's some overall global stat to either accrue or work towards, or
yeah, for sure. It adds another dimension, doesn't it? I mean, we all love achievements. That's why we're here.
Yeah.
So without them, there's something missing.
We've got another question about Sea of Thieves from Pulsey G Gingerbeard.
The best kind of ginger, best kind of beard.
Yep.
He says, this is a silly question, but I don't think it is. He says,
does it
hurt or improve Sea of Thieves for not having a story?
What do you think, Dave?
I think these games tend to always struggle, but I think it's more about our perception of what we're expecting rather than, you know, like I can't remember in the marketing campaign for the game building up, they never said there's going to be an epic story or something, but you kind of expect some direction and
stuff like that. Can you remember a game that doesn't have a story? It's quite weird.
Well, coming on to a game that's been announced today for the Xbox One that suffered a similar thing, I think people saw things and thought that's a really cool idea and then expected to be doing this, like a story in the world. And then when it comes as just like make your own adventure type game, this is. Loads of people are put off. I think if you're going into it with that kind of notion that you know it's up to you what you make of it, then it's fine. But I think it will put off a lot of people. Like they'll go into it and go, "There's nothing to do. Where's the story?" We're so kind of.
I think, as she says, at least they've been upfront about it. So obviously, No Man's Sky, that was a different story. They promised the world, didn't they?
Yeah,
and they just didn't deliver anything they promised.
They stretched the truth somewhat before the game announced.
Yeah, but Sea of Thieves has been totally transparent. But in terms of it just not having a story, for me, that definitely just hurts. It just feels too shallow. It doesn't feel like there's anything
shallow
to really do.
Good one.
I don't know why
we were going to get some sea-related puns.
I'd almost like them to take a step towards Assassin's Creed Black Flag, if that makes sense. So some bigger islands with more stuff to do on them, maybe some proper building, some quests on those islands, rather than just sail to this island, collect this thing, go back to this one.
I think it does, as I say, Mark was saying that it does open up a bit after about 15 to 20 hours, and the missions themselves are much more interesting.
Okay. But it's 15 to 20 hours to get to that point.
I know, exactly.
Seems a bit...
But this is an MMO, so they expect people to... I mean, I was reading it. There's a thread on the site now about trying to get the achievement. You know those massive achievements?
Yeah.
The 1,000 voyages, yeah.
Trying to get the requirements dropped. So there's a link to a post on Rare's forum, and there's a bit of a drive to try and get some of those reduced, which would be interesting if that succeeds or not. So if you're... if you're fed up with the huge completion time. I mean, I'm guessing no one's done any of those achievements. Oh, we can't tell, can we?
No, we can't. It sounds like it's going to be a mutiny, though, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yay!
I don't know why.
It seems to be like impossible, though, for developers to kind of get a good mix of the two. It's like, you know, like you played The Division. I really enjoyed the story, but the bit at the end was not great. And people who liked the grinding bit said it wasn't great. And then people, it's where it is just grinding. There's no story to do. And
that's a good kind of parallel, actually. I hadn't thought about that. It's pretty much just like an end game, but without the bit before it.
I just don't seem what it's like. I don't know. It's like the developers just seem to really struggle to get like a co-op story that isn't repetitive and then has stuff to do at the end of it that makes you want to stay. It doesn't sound that hard to do, but it obviously is.
I should mention the Far Cry 5 achievements are excellent. There's a couple of slightly grindy ones, but they all look like they're going to be really good fun. So, yeah, just another plug for Far Cry 5, which is already my game of the year.
I read something about fishing and thought I'm not going to enjoy that
fishing?
One.
Yeah, fishing's awesome.
Got to collect 4 fish or something like
that. Yeah, I've already done that.
Rare fish.
Easy. Just you get your rod.
No, you got to go to areas and you got to get the record-breaking fish. So you're going to have to sit fishing for ages in a specific area.
Oh, really?
To get a specific
record. It's quite clever, though. So as you're driving around, you'll see signs at the side of the road. And if you stop, get out of the car and walk up to them, it will have an animal on it. And then that then shows you what animals are in that area. And that then goes onto your map. So if you're looking for moose or, you know, badgers or grizzly bears or whatever, once you've found enough signs, you can literally go to the direct point on the map and hunt those things. And it's the same with the fish. So there are certain lakes that specialize in like rock carp or bass or whatever. God, I know more about fish now than I've ever known before.
I'm only like an hour in, so I've got
I forgot you were playing it. I didn't even ask you. How are you finding it?
It's good. The introduction was really well done, and it looks amazing. The game looks amazing. Yeah. But I've just got to the stage where I've opened up the first island. That's like as far as I got, so I'm probably
That's the intro tutorial sort of thing.
Yeah.
So in fact, there's a brilliant bit in that where you have to climb this radio tower, and anyone that's played any of the Far Cry games will remember that I think Far Cry 4, you had to climb like 30 towers or maybe even 50 towers to unlock the whole of the map. You climb this enormous tower, and it's got that, you know, remember the blue ropes that sort of dangle down that give you an indication that you can jump onto them and climb up that bit. You climb this vast tower, and it's like, oh yeah, I'm playing a Far Cry game. And you get to the top, and then the radio comes on, and the guy goes, "Hey, get yourself down from there. You didn't think I was going to make you climb towers all day, did you?" And that's it. And that's the last time you ever climb a tower. It's amazing. So it's a very different Far Cry game. Also, there's some amazing GTA style side plots. There's some really cool, crazy characters, sort of stereotypical Midwest American lunatics that have got some, you know, conspiracy theories and alien abductions and all that sort of stuff. And that really lightens the tone because the main storyline's pretty gruesome at times, but it's got like torture and pretty horrendous murders and all sorts of stuff. So to have that stuff to do on the side really breaks it up, and there's a wingsuit, and you know, it feels quite GTA-ish at times. God, I just can't stop raving about that game. I want to play it now. Okay, any other news?
Yeah, so today, a game similar to Sea of Thieves but set in space, No Man's Sky, has been announced. It's arriving on the Xbox One this summer, so it was previously a PlayStation 4 and PC exclusive title. I think it was fair to say that flopped at release. From going off the story, there's been 3 kind of pretty sizable updates over time. There's another one coming that kind of coincides with
the next update. It's called.
So I suppose it doesn't look like my type of game, but I suppose people should kind of see where it's actually at now instead of just dismissing it off.
Apparently it's a very different game to the original launch version.
It's probably worth giving it a try then.
Yeah, I imagine we might stream it. Yeah. But yeah, we'll know more about the next update. Apparently it's their most significant update so far. And the others look like they've been pretty major. So this could be huge. Maybe it will finally have the multiplayer stuff if they haven't added that already.
It's pretty much the recurring comment on Twitter to that story was, why?
We've got a comment on our article. Somebody said, it's for one PlayStation exclusive we didn't want.
Oh, wow. Oh, that is harsh. Having said that, if you check out that new story that's gone up today, there's some screenshots on there. It's a beautiful looking game. Absolutely stunning looking game.
Yeah.
Right, and is it Xbox One X enhanced? I think it is.
It is,
yes. Yeah. Yeah, HDR and 4K, yeah.
And more, it says as well, so I don't know what more is.
8K.
Yeah.
16K.
Another game announced this week, Lego The Incredibles has been officially announced. I love The Incredibles, but not so keen on Lego games, so I'm torn on this one.
Yeah, they just seem to be crowbarring anything into the Lego sort of brand now, don't they? But The Incredibles is an awesome film.
It's a franchise.
There's a second one, is there a second one?
Yeah, coming out soon, I think.
Yeah, it might be tied into that then.
Should do Lego A Way Out. That'd be amazing.
Lego is kind of...
You'd have to play through it twice.
Lego games are kind of like Telltale games. They're on every device, and there'll probably be a 360 version launches with it at the same time or something, just to coin it in a bit more. But yeah.
That could be good.
Could be.
I like the sound
I think
of
it
that.
Suits the style, doesn't it?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, and it'll be kind of like the Marvel games where you got some characters that can fly and all that kind of stuff. So I imagine it'll work well if you like Lego
games.
The
screenshots and the trailer both look awesome, so yeah. I recommend you check those out.
And then last bit this week, Far Cry 3, the classic edition that was announced as part of the season pass for Far Cry 5. It's going to be releasing on May the 29th, so that gives you plenty of time to actually work your way through Far Cry 5, and then you go back and play with the nutter that was Vaz, who's probably the best enemy in a game ever, I think.
Yeah, he's awesome. So I got that for free.
I'm guessing that's going to have a separate achievement. Well, I say separate achievement list, but obviously maybe the same achievement list as the
original. Stack, but-
Yeah,
yeah, I would have thought so. Yeah.
So it's 29th if you're on the season pass, and then you're going to be able to purchase it separately on June the 26th. So
it's a belting game.
It is. Definitely worth it.
Excellent. Back and pack news?
Nothing. This week, tumbleweed.
Okay. Right, let's move into the mailbag.
Yeah, so we had to cut some out, unfortunately, because we're short for time. But question of the week this week is from Sergio Hernandez. He's been playing some older games lately, like 5 to 10 years old games, and has noticed a couple of things. Do you think achievements were more of an afterthought for many games before and have evolved to be more interesting?
Shall I take this one? I think they definitely were initially. Developers didn't really know how to get the most out of achievements. And I think for some games, especially cross-platform games, because the trophy system wasn't on PlayStation initially, so anything that came out cross-platform, they just sort of had to crowbar them in at the end for the Microsoft one.
Yeah.
Very often they didn't think about it. There wasn't a huge history of games with great achievement lists to go and look at and research and give yourself ideas with. But now, certainly, I won't mention Far Cry again. Shall I mention Far Cry again? So, as I said, the achievement list of Far Cry is ace. I imagine the achievement list in A Way Out was good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's interesting, yeah.
Yeah, it was a bit different, that one, though. Nothing tied to main story or anything. It was all
That's what I mean. I think that in itself is quite interesting.
It just made you play in a different way and do
exactly,
things.
Exactly, and that's what it should do.
Yeah.
If you compare, going back to, the early... like Madden titles that would have like 10 achievements that you could win in one game compared to now where they sort of like encourage you to, try out different game modes and complete seasons and stuff. Yeah. And similar for FIFA, there was that World Cup game with like 5 achievements.
Yes. World Cup, South Africa.
One was like a 500G that was pretty hard. But compared to now where it's like everything and lots of stuff. So they've definitely learned how to use them.
Yeah, they use them as a device to make sure people experience every portion of the game.
Yeah. And a bit of a sales tool for FIFA, so you have to go and stick some hard-earned dollars into foot.
Buy 500 Ultimate Team players.
And they've definitely realised that people buy DLC if it's got achievements as well, haven't they? Now everything has pretty much a DLC, whereas I remember it being like a rare occurrence, like Call of Duty, you get some maps or something and that was it.
Yeah, so I think most developers have learnt quite a lot. It does feel like some of the ID titles are a bit sort of bolted on the end.
Yeah.
Some of them. But that might be because they're ported from perhaps a mobile game where they didn't have any to start with.
Yeah, I think that fits into the same thing you had mentioned earlier about PlayStation and where that didn't have a trophy to start with. So if that isn't there, it's definitely an afterthought.
Yeah. I think I think the big developers and the big publishers now, they'll think about the achievements while they're making the game. And when I think that makes, that's what makes a big difference.
Yeah.
Good question though, Sergio. That was our question of the week.
Yeah, shall I get in touch with you and give you a choice of codes? Next question from Ian Triplo. Far Cry or Sea of Thieves, which one are you more likely to complete and why?
Well, Far Cry, because
you're going to say Sea of Thieves. Come on.
Yeah, Sea of Thieves. No. For many reasons. Far Cry is completable because four people on the site have already completed it. No one has completed Sea of Thieves, and the achievements are broken at the moment. So no one is likely to. Also, the achievement requirements for Sea of Thieves look ridiculous, and I'm probably not going to play it very much. So all of those lead me to the conclusion that Far Cry 5 is far more likely.
I'm going to say the same, just same reasons, and it's kind of the story-driven games like appeal to me far more than do your own thing in a sandbox world type stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. By the way, if you are on the fence about Sea of Thieves and you haven't played it or seen much of it, do check out Mark's review, because it is, he does highlight the really cool stuff that's in that game, and it will appeal to certain people. I know it's not for everyone, but certain people absolutely love it. People are saying it's the game, you know, best game they played on the Xbox One sort of thing. So if you can, if it's the type of thing that you think you would enjoy, then do give it a go. Yeah, don't let the achievement list put you off.
I mean, we had a lot of fun when we played it together, didn't we, at Gamescom?
Yeah, we had loads of fun. So yeah, that's true.
Just kind of, maybe it's because,
and it's much evolved from there.
Yeah, opinion.
I'm going to say the same thing. It's going to have to be Far Cry, because Sea of Thieves just doesn't appeal to me from what I've played of it. Haven't played Far Cry either yet, but just more likely to enjoy it and put the time in to finish it.
It's really good.
Yeah, I've heard it's really good. I don't know who's been saying that, but
really good. The worst thing was I was embargoed. I couldn't even say it was really good for the first 3 days. That was painful.
Okay, so a couple of new achievement lists this week. We've had Terror with 25 achievements, another ACA Neo Geo game, Sengoku 3 with 12 achievements, Enigmatis 3, The Shadow of the Kakahala, or Karkala. Yeah. 35 achievements. I butchered that name. There's some new DLCs too. We've got The Infinite Onslaught in Killing Floor 2, Book 3 in Eye of a Storm, in Ken Follett's The Pillars of the Earth, and Injustice 2 on Windows 10 has had the Legendary update. So it's got Legendary update and then loads of different character loads packs with one achievement each.
Okay. Excellent. Okay. Let's quickly talk about new releases. I don't think there's anything major coming out. Alteric comes out tomorrow. Terra, The Adventure Pals, Minute, and Metropolis, Lux Obscura, Impact Winter, ACA Neo Geo, King of Fighters 99, all come out next week. We have to go because we're streaming now. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week. Bye.
Bye.
Have a good Easter.
Catch you later.
Don't eat too much chocolate. Bye.